Physical quantities can be classified into two categories. One is scalar, the other one is vectors. We know that the scalar word has come from the scaling, that is simply a number. We can give lot many examples: distance, time, mass, density, area, speed, volume, and work done. These are all the physical quantities which are called as scalars. Now let us go through the second type of physical quantities, vectors. Vectors. Some physical quantities can be described completely by magnitude and direction. Here the key word is the direction. Unless and until you know the direction, you cannot completely describe that particular physical quantity. For example, if somebody asks, if I apply certain force on a football, where it will go? So you cannot answer that question unless and until you know in which direction he is kicking the football, he is applying the force on the football. Suppose if he applies the force in one particular direction, in the same direction the football will move. So unless and until you know the details of direction of application, you cannot completely understand that quantity. Rather, you cannot completely describe that quantity. And those physical quantities which needs, apart from magnitude, the direction also are called vectors. Now let's go through some of the vectors. Displacement is a vector. Acceleration, velocity, momentum, force, gravitational field intensity, torque, angular momentum, and electrical field intensity, and many other. A vector is represented by an arrow mark having one head, the other tail. So in this vector, P represents the tail and Q represents the head. This PQ bar is a vector which is initiated from P and move towards the Q. Similarly, here it starts from A and move towards B. Here it starts from L and move towards M. After all, why do we study the vectors? Suppose if an object is on the inclined plane and it is sliding down, definitely the weight is one of the factors affecting the motion. Will the entire mg will cause the block to come down or some part of it? So to know that, vectors are compulsory. In the pendulum, if it is taken to a particular height and it is released, then how much the acceleration is applied because of the gravitational pull. So here also, unless and until we know the vectorial picture, you cannot calculate the acceleration due to gravity component that is acting on the simple pendulum. And unless and until we know that, we cannot find out the time period of the simple pendulum. So to know many things in physics, vectors are very compulsory for us to study. Now, suppose if several forces are acting on a particular object in different directions, if you want to calculate the net force acting on the body, again we have to take the help of vectors. Similarly, to calculate the relative velocities and in many more cases in physics, we have to apply the knowledge of vectors. So studying vectors is compulsory for us to understand the physics deeply. Now sometimes, even though they are not vectors, they are scalars, but still we make it
vectors by assigning a direction to it. For example, area is made as a vector. In fact, area is a scalar. That's what I have given the example, the area under the scalars. But area is made as a vector by assigning an outward normal as the direction of it. Then, second example, electric dipole moment. You would have studied in chemistry that the electrical dipole moment is nothing but length of the dipole and the magnitude of the charges. Here, the length of the dipole is a scalar and the electric charge is also scalar. But still, their product, we are considering it as a vector by assigning a specific direction minus to plus, negative to positive charges. Why? Why do we make these scalars as vectors? The answer is to get the results in accordance with the experiments in rotational mechanics and in vector products. So, you will come to know that in some of the cases, unless and until we give a specific direction to area, specific direction to electric dipole, we cannot find out the results of the experiments related to the electricity and some of the experiments related to water flow and some other cases. So, we have to make some scalars as vectors because they are required in rotational mechanics and other vector products. So, here you can see the direction this outward normal for this surface is the vector, and for the downward surface this N2 is the vector. Similarly, here this is negative, this is positive, therefore the electric dipole moment vector is from negative to positive. It is taken from negative to positive so that when we apply the same direction in electric dipole moment, we get the same results that are actually happening in the electric fields. That's the reason why it is given as negative to positive. In some of the textbooks, you will find that it is convention. Every convention should also have some experimental support. So, this is the reason why we give the negative to positive direction for the electric dipole moment. Now, let us be familiar with types of vectors, and here I would like to mention some of the vectors. Unit vectors, null vectors, parallel vectors, equal vectors, coplanar vectors, co-initial vectors, co-terminus vectors, negative vectors, and position vectors. These are all different types of vectors. Now let us go through their definition one after the other. So here, unit vector, the name itself suggests that if the magnitude of a vector is one unit, what does it mean? When we talk about forces, 1 newton is called as one unit vector. When we talk about the displacements, 1 meter is the unit vector for it. When we talk about torque, 1 newton meter is unit vector. So, when we talk about acceleration, 1 meter per second square is unit vector. These unit vectors, if they are along the x-axis, we call it as I cap or I hat. You can see a symbol is placed over I, that is I cap or I hat. So, whenever you write the unit vectors, you must make this special caps over the unit vectors. In x direction, it is called I cap, and in y direction, it is j cap, and in z direction, it is k cap. What is the use of these unit vectors? Any vector can be expressed in terms of unit vectors. Suppose if a vector is situated somewhere here, a point is situated here, which is from the origin at certain distance. Let it be r distance. and it is x units in x direction, y units in y direction, and z units in z direction, then that OR can be explained as xi plus yj plus zk. Now let's see some of the vectors represented like that. So here in this figure, I have taken the two-dimensional figure. In this two-dimensional figure, this is representing positive x-axis, this is representing positive y, negative x-axis, and then this downwards is negative y-axis. Now here, if a point is situated at 3, 2, then if it is joined from the origin to that point, it is called position vector. And that position vector can be expressed as 3i plus 2j. Similarly, suppose if a point exists here, then 3 units in x-axis and it's 3 units in y-axis, then we can write it as minus 3i. Why? Because in the negative x-axis, the unit vector is with negative sign, minus I cap. So minus 3i cap plus 3j cap. Similarly, in the third quadrant, both negatives, and in the fourth quadrant, x is positive and y is negative. So in this way, any vector can be expressed as the combination of the unit vectors. So if the vector is there in the three-dimensional plane, then the k term will also come. Suppose if it is away 3 units in x direction and 2 units in y direction and 6 units in z direction, then we call it as 3i plus 2j plus 6k. The motion in two-dimensional planes, so we are considering only I and j's here. So null vector means whose magnitude is 0. Then what's the use of defining this null vector? Because this has got certain properties, and these properties, any vector is added to a null vector resulting the same vector. Actually, we can add a vector to a vector. You cannot add a vector and a scalar. So that's why we have to define a null vector, because when we are subtracting one vector from the same vector, you will get 0. Now, if that 0 is simply a scalar, means it is violating the law. Therefore, we have to define the null vector whose magnitude is 0. Now, suppose if you hear that O vector is representing this null vector, and if it is added to A, we will get again A. Suppose a vector is subtracted from the same vector, then the resulting vector will be null vector, according to the definition, of course. Then next, a null vector is subtracted from any vector, you will get the same vector. A bar minus O bar or 0 bar is equal to A bar. So null vector is also very important to be defined. Now, if two vectors are parallel to each other, then they are called parallel vectors. Here, the PQ vector is parallel to AB vector. Suppose if the direction of PQ vector is Q to P, then they are called anti-parallel vectors. If the two vectors are parallel, at the same time they are equal in magnitude, then they are called equal vectors. So here, in this diagram, if you take AB bar from A to B, this is a parallelogram, and this is DC bar. So here AB is parallel to DC, at the same time AB is equal to DC. Similarly, AD is parallel to BC and AD is equal to BC. Therefore, this AD bar is equal to BC bar. So when we write the vectors on paper, this arrow mark is compulsory. In textbooks, the arrow marks, in some of the textbooks, the arrow marks they may not mention, because they will take the bold letters to represent the vectors. Now, if many vectors are there on the same plane, then we call it as coplanar vectors. And if the vectors are on a straight line, then they are called collinear vectors. If the vectors are initiated from the same point and moving away from that point, then they are called co-initial vectors, because initial point is same for all. Now, if the terminus point is same, all are coming towards one particular point, then they are called coterminous vectors. Now, it is very important to define another vector called negative vector. Suppose if I consider this A to B is in positive direction. Now, if I take the vector from B to A, then it is in the negative direction. So, this for AB vector, BA vector is negative. Now, this is one of the most important vectors, position vectors. Now, if any point, suppose I have taken several points on this plane, and then if I take one reference point as origin, and if I join that Q to that origin, then OQ is called the position vector at Q. Now, let me show it to you. This OQ is the position vector of Q. OP is the position vector of P. OR is the position vector of R. And OS is the position vector of S. How to express any vector in terms of its position vectors? Now, let's take two vectors. One is OP is a position vector and another vector OQ. Now, if I want to represent PQ, so, if I wanted to know PQ, I have to use one vector law addition called triangular law of adding the vectors. So, here O to P, P to Q is equal to O to Q. Let's take an example like displacement, which you have studied in class 9th. Somebody goes from O to P and then towards right he moves and he stops at Q. Then what is the displacement? How we have done? To calculate the displacement, we have joined the initial point, that is O, and the terminating point, that is Q, and we have joined. So that OQ will give us the resultant displacement. So, but what is it actually? Original path, he has moved O to P, then P to Q. So, OP vector plus PQ vector is OQ vector. Remember that the magnitude of OP plus magnitude of PQ will never be equal to OQ. In any triangle, the length of one side is always lesser than that of the sum of the other two sides. Here, this length itself is representing the magnitude of the vector. So, we talked about the direction. The arrow mark is showing the direction, and the magnitude is represented by the length of the vector. So here OP is having some magnitude, PQ is the smaller vector with smaller length we are showing it, that means its magnitude is less. Now here we can express that OP plus PQ is equal to OQ. Our aim is to calculate PQ. So when OP plus PQ is equal to OQ, then I can say PQ as OQ minus OP. Similarly, if I want to know PQ, I have to take the second letter's position vector minus first letter's position vector. Here, second letter's position vector is OP minus first letter's position vector is OQ. Even I can apply for polygon law. Suppose if this is this Q is somewhere here, then R. If I join OR, I can write OP plus PQ plus QR is equal to OR. Now, actually this represents not only in magnitude but also in direction. So, the OQ is final vector, the resultant vector of OP and PQ. What does it indicate? It is the net displacement. If you take the example of displacement, it gives the net displacement not only in the magnitude but also in the, we can look at the point by using the direction of that displacement. Now, addition of vectors. How do we add two vectors? We have already discussed every vector will have one tail and one head. So, if you keep second vector's tail on the first vector's head and then join the first vector's tail to the second vector's head. Let's see that. So, here PQ plus AB I wanted to have. So, what should I do? I should place A on Q. Now I got B here. So now the resultant vector is the line joining connecting P and B. So in this way, we can find out the resultant vector. Now suppose if they are subtracted. So what we have to do, this AB direction should be changed. That is, in the case of subtraction, we have to take the reverse direction of second vector. So here I have taken A bar plus B bar. So in the same, this is the positive P direction. So this is A plus B bar. Now, if I wanted to know A bar minus B bar. So this is A bar. I have drawn parallel vector to this one. And then this is also parallel to this one. But here the direction is reversed. So this is minus B. If it is plus B, we have already talked about the negative vectors. This is minus B. So now here A bar minus B bar is equal to this vector. So this is A minus B. So in that way, we can add or subtract. Now let's see if in any problem, if A bar is given as 3i minus 5j plus 4k and B bar is I plus j minus k, then if the question is asked as A plus B bar, A bar plus B bar, the sum of the two vectors, straight away, just like algebraic addition, we can do it. 3 plus 1, 4, minus 5 plus 1, minus 4, and 4 minus 1, 3. Similarly, if you want to subtract 3 minus 1, 2, minus 5 minus 1, minus 6, and 4 minus of minus 1, plus 5. So it is as good as the algebraic addition. Now here, if you look at this, A and B are given. So straight away, we have to add 3 plus 2, 3 minus 1, and then 4 plus 5. Similarly, A minus B, 2 minus 3, then 3 minus of minus 1, 4 minus 5. So in that way, we can add or subtract. So this addition or subtraction is just like algebraic operation. Okay, in this video, we have talked about the vector. Next, we have talked about different types of vectors, scalars, and their resultant vectors, addition of two vectors, and the subtraction of two vectors. In the next video, we will talk about the product, which is very, very important, and it is very much different from the algebraic product. Please don't forget to subscribe the channel.